compact Riemannian engel for the finite graph, or any other nice metric space. And you want to understand this object, but all the information you can gain from this object, you can use from this object is the following. You can take random points, and you take the R neighborhood of your random point. And so you sample the space at random places in some bounded neighborhood. And then you look at the distribution that you get. And this is the information you want to use. And you want to predict properties of this graph or manifold using this data. So sampling. So we know the distribution for A balls on the graph, or what do we know about the, what can we say? What properties can be predicted with some error? What properties cannot be predicted? So this is, if there were computer scientists here, I would tell that this is exactly the same as running a constant time algorithm and asking what can you decide with a constant time algorithm, or also what they call property testing, one of the meanings. But it's a meaningful question in itself. And now we will introduce a kind of convergence. Now we will stick to graphs for a while. Maybe we will come back to Riemannian manifolds a little bit later. So you take your finite graphs. And surprisingly, the answer depends on, well, surprisingly or unsurprisingly, it depends on what kind of universe we are. So one of the cases that is the dense case means the number of edges is proportional to n square, the number of vertices square. That's a very well-developed theory by Lovasz and Szegedy and a lot of other people. So I'm not naming all the list here. And Lotzi is just writing a nice book about it. And this is not what I will be talking about today. So the other extreme of this universe is the bounded degree case, and this is what I want to talk about today. So, and then there is kind of the intermediate case where we will, so the degree of x is less than c with some absolute constant. And then there is the intermediate case, and no one really knows what you should do there. So that's a black box right now. This bounded degree case can be, in many cases, relaxed to having the average degree bounded, but that's about it. And then once you're done, so let me introduce the closeness or a convergence notion. Let's see where it goes. So let alpha be a finite rooted graph. And then for some given R, P, G, R, alpha, that's the probability that the ball of radius R centered at V is isomorphic to alpha, where V is in VG random. OK? So that's a sampling probability. So you pick a finite graph G, and you pick this. You fix this sample, you look at the probability that you see this pattern alpha arising from a random point. The convergence notion that belongs to this theory is so-called Benjamini-Schramm convergence. So Gn is Benjamini-Schramm convergent if for all alpha and r, this probability P Gn r alpha converges. Okay, so that's the convergence notion. So that means that, in this universe, two large graphs are close if we cannot distinguish them by sampling the R-balls in that space. So okay, so I never told you, I told you what convergence is, and this is an understandable object. I never told you what the limit object is. So intuitively, what is the limit of the path of length n? Where should it converge as n tends to infinity? Well, yeah? Well, it must converge to the infinite line, right? Because if you take the infinite line, the root to the infinite line, then what you will see from this, the R-ball, this is what you will see from most points of the line. The same goes for a large cycle. Okay, so where does the n by n grid converge? So what's the limit of the n by n grid in that sense? Although I never defined what the limit is. Yeah, the infinite grid, right? So okay, so after all this big preparation, tell me a graph sequence that converges to the free regular tree. What's a graph sequence that converges to the free regular tree? Okay. So this is a small audience, but when I always ask this question and I give this kind of talk, and there is always someone who gives the wrong answer. Very obvious but wrong answer. Gabor, thanks for what? So yeah, the usual wrong answer is that you take the free regular tree and you take a ball in it. Okay, you like chop it down somewhere, and this is Gn. And of course, you know, in the conventional sense, this converges to the free regular tree. But in this sense, it doesn't converge to the free regular tree. Why? Because a positive proportion of this graph of Gn is on the boundary of Gn, so it has degree 1. Okay? So this sequence will not converge to the free regular tree, because from a positive proportion of the points, you don't see a free regular tree. You see a degree 1, and then, you know, something's happening. It's a very good exercise. It's the first good exercise in this subject to see where it converges. It indeed converges to something nice, and it's a good exercise to solve what it converges. It's a completely describable nice object. It's a good exercise to see where it converges. Now, okay, this I'm saying without defining the limit object, so let's define the limit object. So to do that, you have to be one step more abstract. You could do it from here, but it would be a bit forced. Instead, you can just do the following. So if G is a finite graph, then assign a root randomly assign its root at random. This gives you a thing that I will call lambda G. It's a random rooted graph. Okay. So what is that? So we have an absolute degree bound. So we fix this degree C forever in our universe. So what is this in reality? This is to first consider the space of rooted graphs with this degree bound. Okay, so that's the universe we are looking at. And the space of rooted graphs with a given degree bound is a compact space. Simply, I define the distance between two rooted graphs is that I take the largest ball such that they coincide on the balls, and I take 1 over that radius. Okay, so that's a compactification of that space. And every sequence will have a convergent subsequence, which is a triviality. So the space of rooted graphs is a compact space. And now every finite graph, when I push this lambda button, it becomes a probability measure on the space of rooted graphs. Okay. So lambda key is a probability measure on the space of rooted graphs. Okay. And now Benjamini-Schramm convergence in this language is simply V convergence of measures. So Gn Benjamini-Schramm converges if and only if lambda Gn weakly converges, which is just an observation, but it allows you to define the limit very naturally. Simply the Benjamini-Schramm limit of a graph sequence will be the weak limit of the corresponding measures. So it will be a random rooted graph, a random, probably, most likely infinite rooted graph. Okay? So in that sense, now we can ask these questions. And actually, this is the tricky question was something that Benjamin and Schramm was quite aware of. Actually, what you can prove, and that I don't think that's a hard proof. I think that's not so hard. But if you take Benjamini-Schramm limit of trees, then what you get is a random graph, right? It's a random infinite graph, and this random infinite graph is recurrent, almost surely. Which means that it very much doesn't look like a big tree. So no matter how big trees you start with, the limit from most points, it's recurrent. And the Benjamini-Schramm theorem, the first theorem of this subject, says that the limit of planar graphs is recurrent, almost surely. Okay? So this says that planar graphs may look large or, you know, very connected individually. But from most points, they are not very connected to infinity, or they are not very connected to their far points, which, you know, recurrent means that the random walk returns infinitely many times on that graph. So that was the starting theorem of that subject, and this is how the convergence notion was invented. So you should look at this whole limit theory is kind of a compromise. The compromise is that, obviously, you can just look at rooted limits, right? This kind of universe. And obviously, rooted limit doesn't catch anything from the graph. Because if you take just rooted limit of a graph sequence, then most of the interesting stuff will disappear in infinity. It will be pushed out to infinity, and you will never see it again in the limit. So the compromise is that, okay, I still do the same, but I do it at least from every point, and I remember the distribution of what I get. So it's still some kind of global information is saved from the graph. Nothing is lost forever, so everything appears somewhere in that limit space. And it is a compromise, because we will see that it remembers some things from the graph, and it doesn't remember others. Nevertheless, since this is a computer science talk, I have to point out that if it remembers, or if something behaves well, then you can actually do the following. I give you a huge graph, you know, size 10 to the 10,000, which means that I don't really give it to you, but it's given. Some computer can access it and tell me whether what are connecting and what are not. And I want you to compute some parameter for this graph, and I allow you small error. Then you can actually come up with a constant time algorithm. You can tell me, okay, so here is what I do. I sample it at random places. I don't have to make a lot of samples. I look at a bounded radius. So this is a very, very small part of the space, you know, opposite to what I'm drawing. And then based on that, I can make a very, very good educated guess which will have very small error from the truth with a very high probability. Okay, so that's a practically useful thing to know, as much as computer science is practical. If you want to go very concrete and use it for concrete, you know, implementations, then this abstract convergence notion has to be switched to proper estimates. So let's call a parameter. So just a function. So p, which grows from the space of graphs. First, let it go to R. Okay, and that's a graph parameter. Okay, but this can be really any topological space. But most of the examples will be just real numbers. So this P is testable. Well, if it's Benjamini-Schramm continuous. If P of Gn converges whenever Gn Benjamini-Schramm converges. Okay. So that's the notion. And if this is not true, then we call it not testable. So let's have what are trivial examples for testable? What is a testable property? So for example, the average number of edges. Of course, that's a testable property. The degree, the average degree. The density of triangles, that's a testable value. I only have to look at radius 1 to know that. Okay, so let's have a more surprising example for testable. So that's the matching ratio okay. So that's the maximum matching inside the divided by the size of G in the graph is testable. This is due to, well, Elek and Lipner, and also Nguyen and Onak. These guys are computer scientists, and they gave actual estimates on how bad it gets. So that's a non-trivial theorem. You have to work to get that. Okay. So maybe a bit surprisingly, but the independence ratio is not testable. It's testable. Not testable. And the independence ratio is the maximal independent subset of the graph. And you know from, if you never worked on these things, these two things look pretty similar because the maximal matching is just an independent set of edges in the graph, and there's just an independent set of vertices. So here is why it's not testable. If you take random d-regular bipartite graphs or random d-regular graphs, the independence ratio of a random d-regular bipartite graph is, of course, 1/2. And the independence ratio of a random d-regular graph, that's bounded away from 1/2, which is a theorem of Lovasz. And it's not so easy to prove. You go ahead and prove it. And on the other hand, both sequences converge to the d-regular tree. From most points of a random d-regular graph, be it bipartite or non-bipartite, you just see a tree. Actually, you can go as far as constant times log n, and you still see a tree. So in that sense, it has asymptotically optimal injectivity radius from most points, not from every point. So Benjamini-Schramm converge to the tree. But the independence ratio converges to different objects. And actually, you would think that, OK, so it's easy to see that for that for random regular graphs, the independence ratio is convergent. This was an open problem of Aldus for more than 10 years, and it was just solved recently by Tetali, Gamarnik, and someone I always forget, which is not nice. But they still don't know what the limit is. They can prove that the limit exists for independence ratio, but they don't know what the limit is. Okay. So these are two examples. So in group theory, just very shortly, this is interesting because if you have a group gamma, it's generated by a finite set S, and this is an infinite group, and you take two finite quotients, you take M1 and N2, these are two normal subgroups, finite index normal subgroup of large index, deep enough, you take the two quotient graphs, two quotient Cayley graphs, then they behave very differently as graphs. Globally, they can behave very differently, but locally they will be the same. Locally they will be very close. So I came to this whole subject because I studied resolutions. This is not N2. You know, resolutions of infinite groups by different chains of subgroups of finite index. And I wanted to know how to relate natural properties of these different chains, or if you want, covering towers of a manifold, that, you know, two covering towers that both converge to the universal cover, both open up to the universal cover. I wanted to understand how natural asymptotics behaves on those covering towers. And this is exactly the only information that you have here is this kind of local convergence first. So because from the sampling probability, I mean, sampling-wise, they will look the same. Okay, so this gets you to actually a non-trivial theorem, which is a bit surprising because this, at least I would guess that you could say that something is too global. If something is too global, it means that it's a global property and it's too global to just catch by this kind of local sampling, right? So surprisingly, if you take the rank of the adjacent symmetrix of G, normalized, divided by G, this is testable. This is a theorem of Luc, basically, although he doesn't know what testable is, but that's still his theorem. So what is that? This is also an independent subset. So this is that you take the adjacency matrix of G, and you choose the maximal independent number of rows, which is to say that you have this graph, and you choose an independent set of vertices, but the set of vertices will not be independent in the graphic sense, it will be independent in the linear sense. Okay? And this is still testable. This number converges for a Benjamini-Schramm convergent graph sequence. There is now one question that you should ask, because this is not well defined, what I just said. What is missing from this definition? What? The adjacency, we know what the adjacency matrix is. There is one bit of information that I never wrote here. I never cared to write here. And this is the field. I mean, okay, what field you are looking at? And this is over Q or C or R, they are all the same, right? Now, if you ask it modulo P, this is open. Okay, this is an open problem, and it would be very interesting to see whether this holds from a topological point of view, because basically this theorem is This theorem encodes this so-called Luc approximation theorem. The Luc approximation theorem says the following. So let me just state it in the simplest form. Luc approximation theorem It's about L to Betti number. So let M be, let it just be a CW complex. It can be any compact manifold, finite. Okay, and I take a regular covering tower of the CW complex that opens it up to its universal cover. So let's take pi 1 of M, take a chain of subgroups in that, such that the gamma I are normal in pi 1 of M. The intersection of gamma I is 1. So that's like a way to open this. And then, so let Mn be, take the universal cover of M, divided it by back by gamma n. Okay, so that's the nth element of this covering tower. And now look at how the Betti numbers of this complex behave when normalized by the index of the cover. So then the limit n goes to infinity bk of mn divided by gamma index gamma n equals the kth L to Betti number of m, okay, or the kth L to Betti number of the universal cover, okay, and if you don't know or don't care what, so this is for OK. If you don't know what, or you don't care what L to Betti numbers are, that's fine. These are the analogs of Betti numbers, just you count von Neumann dimension instead of normal dimension. You do L2. You do L2 traces and L2 orthogonal projections. So you play it on the L2 level, and then you look at von Neumann dimension, and that's a very well-studied invariant in topology. So even if you don't care about it, you have to respect this theorem, because this is some number, some mysterious number that is attached to this one. This is one number that is attached to M, right? And this tells you that no matter how you resolve your compact manifold, how you open it up in the fundamental group, the Betti numbers, the asymptotic of the Betti numbers, the growth of Betti numbers is independent of this opening. Okay? And you know, this connection works both ways. So you can prove theorems about Betti numbers using this correspondence. And actually, it works the other way around. You can compute L2 Betti numbers of some spaces using this correspondence. So this was actually, this goes back a long story. So the study of these numbers started with Atiyah, and then Kasdan had an inequality, and Kasdan conjectured that this equality holds, and then Luc was the one who proved it. So here is the thing. This is all Q. This is a Betti numbers, rational Betti numbers mod Q. Okay? And we don't know anything like this in mod P homology. Nothing is known. It would be very helpful, just like it happens in finite group theory, where modular representation theory is much, would be, if it would exist, it would be much more interesting internally than complex representation theory, which is beautiful and it exists. The same way, for some purposes, the mod P homology would be more interesting than the ordinary homology, but we don't have access to it. And if this theorem would hold, if this would go through, if the mod P rank would be testable, this would give rise to mod P L2 Betti numbers. It would tell you that this theorem holds mod P. Of course, this is not a well-defined object, because there is no von Neumann dimension mod P. There is no Hilbert space structure. So this would be a way to define it. Oh, yes, yes, and you get L2 torsion. Pretty. So on this language, you look at the adjacent symmetrics, and and you look at, so that's just, you look at the lattice generated, the integer lattice generated by it, right? Okay? This integer lattice has a torsion-free part, which you can, which is exactly this rank, right? The Q rank. And then there is the torsion part. This is the covolume, and you're taking the log of the covolume divided by the size of G, and you ask whether that converges. That's exactly what's going on for finitely presented groups.
You can also ask whether it tests the lower part.
Yes. Then this is not known. This is an open problem. Yes. So L2 torsion can be expressed this way too. Okay. So that would be cool. I mean, a lot of topologists, at least that's what they tell me, that they would be happy to have a mod P homology, or mod P L2 homology theory, a virtual one. And this would behave, I mean, we understand this picture enough now, it would behave as some kind of entropy theory, but for non-amenable group actions, which is hardly existing. Louis Bowen did some really great work on that, but that also uses similar machinery. Okay. So, I don't want to destroy this. So this actually led me to think, one can think about this problem, not this, but this problem one can think about as a coloring entropy problem, as follows. So instead of computing the rank of the adjacency matrix, let's compute the dimension of the kernel of the adjacency. That's the same thing, right? That's similar. But what is the kernel? The kernel of the adjacency matrix of G, what is in the kernel? Well, that's nothing else but that you take your graph and you color it mod P, the vertices of the graph. You put mod p numbers on it, right? And you make the assumption that for every point, the sum of the neighbors is zero. That's what it means that it's in the kernel, which means just finitely many configurations. And you count the number of legal colorings with this coloring constraint, and you take the entropy of that, the normalized entropy. So it's a number of p legal colorings the log of that divided by g. That's exactly the same thing as the normalized dimension of the kernel. So computing this, deciding whether this is testable is the same as deciding whether that is testable. And this was my idea, to look at it as a coloring problem. And then you would just ask, if you make a local coloring constraint and you look at the set of legal colorings, whether the log of that, the logarithmic, the normalized log of that, is a local invariant. So we still don't know that. But then I realized that there is this very nice theorem so it's Borg's chase. Kahn and Lotzi. It says that, okay, we don't know that, but some coloring entropy is testable. So let Q be greater than 2 of the maximal degree, which we call C somewhere. Then if you take log on the number of legal Q colorings of G divided by G is testable. Okay, where by legal Q coloring I just mean that I color with Q colors, and I call it a legal coloring if no two neighbors have the same color. Okay, so that's what we call legal coloring or proper coloring in the original sense. This is this chromatic business. Okay, so what's the philosophy for that? Philosophy is somehow, which is not the proof, is that if you take, just take your random the statement makes sense, right? So you take a random legal coloring, and because the you are at least two times the maximal degree, you can just do a greedy coloring. The greedy coloring is I already colored some of the parts. I still have a lot of freedom because the number of constraints here is at most the degree, right? And because I have the degree of freedom is always greater than the constraint, somehow you feel that there is a huge mixing, meaning that you know it will get very independent. If two points are far, then their colors get very, very independent for a random legal coloring. And then you would hope that this itself gives this theorem. Well, it doesn't. You need a much stronger theorem for that. You need to turn to statistical physics. And in the statistical physical language, there is Dobrushin's result that tells you a much stronger independence result that I'm not going into. And that helps you showing this theorem. That's one of the proofs. Okay? And that made me wonder because, well, if you learn graph theory to a certain extent, you know one thing, one beautiful ancient result, that the number of legal Q colorings of a given graph is a polynomial in Q. Okay, this is called a chromatic polynomial. So G is fixed, a fixed graph, then the chromatic polynomial at Q is the number of legal Q colorings. And it turns out that this is a polynomial in Q. You know, then it can be, then I can put any complex number in there, into that polynomial if I want. So this is called a chromatic polynomial. Okay. Now you can take, and people do that, people look at the roots of the chromatic polynomial for a given G. And though this is one of these really mysterious objects, this is called chromatic roots. And everyone who looks at chromatic polynomial at some point falls in love with chromatic roots and hopefully falls out of love after a while because they are really, really hard to treat. So everyone, you know that when you start to compute cyclotomic polynomials, everyone makes the conjecture that all the coefficients are plus or minus 1 or 0, right? And then it's not true. You have to go up to 105 to get that. So similarly, everyone who starts to compute this by hand makes the conjecture that for any graph, all the chromatic roots are on the positive half plane, the complex roots of chromatic polynomials. And this is also not true. And you have to go high enough to prove that. Actually, the opposite is true. The possible chromatic roots are dense on the plane. So there is nothing that you can say about chromatic roots in general. However, there is a beautiful deep theorem of Sokal. This is the same Sokal who made this nice joke on sociologists at some point. He proved that all chromatic roots, so are inside the disk of some constant, max degree times some constant. Okay? So if you give me a bounded degree graph, then all the chromatic roots gather in a bounded disk. And this is a non-trivial theorem. And it's also statistical physics. The language that he used to prove it is statistical physics. So you get aware of this result, and you get aware of this result, right? And then you recognize that what is this? What is the log of the number of Q colorings of G over G? That's nothing else but the log of the chromatic polynomial of G at Q Q, right, divided by the size of G. I can write it as the following. That's the integral of log Q minus X d mu G X, where mu G X is the uniform measure on the chromatic roots. Okay? And basically what it says, what the theorem of Borg, Chase, Kahn, Lovasz says, is that against the log function, if you take this sequence of measures that are supported on a compact set, right, then you get convergence of this integral.
It's for integer Q.
For integer Q. So of course, the next thing you think is that this is simply because this has nothing to do with log. All you use is that this is a continuous function. And what you simply have is that you get weak convergence of the measures, of the chromatic measures. And so at least this is what you think if you're not an analyst, and I'm not an analyst. So it was a good conjecture, and we went along, tried to prove it with the Laci student, Tamás Hubai. And it turns out to be false. It's false simply because you compute the chromatic polynomial is not easy to compute, but at least for the line of length n and the cycle of length n, it can be computed. So the roots can be computed, and then, you know, they just don't have the same shape. There is no weak convergence of measures. Then we realized that there is one thing about this function that we never used, is that it's a complex analytic function if Q is large enough, right? So then we proved this theorem that actually this is true, theorem that for any analytic function on this disk, do I have the disk somewhere? Ah, this is my disk. This is this big disk. So F is analytic on B, then the integral of F x d mu g x is testable. Okay? Well, you know, if you look carefully, well, you don't, because I never told you what this C is less than 8. That's all we know. So actually, this theorem does not imply directly the Borg, Chase, Kahn, Lovasz theorem, only for Q greater than 8, 8d, 8 times the maximal degree. But in the other direction, it implies a bit more. It implies that you don't have to stick to integers. This is true in every complex number outside the bounded disk. So actually, what you get, that the normalized log of the chromatic polynomial itself as a sequence of functions converges to an analytic function outside the bounded disk. And this was a question raised by Borgs. And also Sokal was very interested in that, because this has something to do with the phase transition of Pott's model. But don't ask me questions about that, because I don't know. I never understood what this phase transition business is. I can do the motions, but I don't have a deep understanding of it. So, okay. That's a result, and then later this was generalized in a great generality. By Csikvári and Frankel. This is Peter Frankel. The other Frankel is also Peter Frankel. This is the young Peter Frankel. Yeah. And for Tutte polynomials, which is a generalization of the chromatic polynomial, and also for a very much more general, you know, class of polynomials, and I'm not going into details now. It's kind of exponential type polynomials. Okay, and I will not describe what this is, but I have to give credit, because that when you restrict their proof to our situation, just the chromatic polynomial, even there it's a much simpler proof. So somehow they found the right proof for this theorem. We basically cut out the tree. You know, there is the, you cut out the tree until the whole forest is fell, and that was that. We gave that kind of proof. We just massaged it until it couldn't bear any longer. But that proof is a conceptual beautiful proof. So that's the book proof. Okay. So if I had time and I wanted to, let me see. Should I talk about? Let's talk a little bit about the other type of convergence, which is Let me tell you one more thing because I want to tell you a Riemannian manifold theorem. So you can repeat the same story, actually, in the following universe. So imagine that we are just talking about D-regular graphs. It just makes it not bounded degree, but D-regular. A D-regular finite graph, the universal cover of a D-regular finite graph is a D-regular connected graph, is a D-regular tree. So a D-regular finite graph can be looked at as a model of the D-regular tree, finite model of the D-regular tree. And you ask how good this model is and what does it inherit from the tree. So the nicest way to push this into continuous universe is to take a Lie group and, take the values, the Lie group modulo gamma, where gamma is a lattice. So take Lie groups modulo lattices. Lattices are discrete subgroups of finite covolume. So these are nice manifolds, nice Riemannian manifolds, and they are kind of models for the Lie groups, and you ask how well you model it. So you can introduce the notion of Benjamini-Schramm convergence in the same way because you can, they have a natural volume, and you can test, you can sample them against that volume, and you can look at convergence notion. So I just want to say one. This is a big paper done by 7 people. It's a 7-author paper, and I will just tell their names if I manage. This is usually the hardest part. So it's me, Nicolas Bergeron, Jean Rambeau, Zachary Gelander, Nikolai Nikolov, Ido Samet, and Ian Biringer. Okay. That's the theorem. If G is higher rank simple, Lie group, just think about SL3R. That's the first example for that. Then for any gamma n in G, G mod gamma n converges in the Benjamini-Schramm sense to G. Okay. So, well, the volume should go to infinity. So this means that higher rank simple groups are much stronger than a tree. You can obviously build a sequence of D-regular graphs that does not converge to the tree, right? But you cannot do it. This is not possible in a higher rank simple Lie group. Any sequence of models where the volume, which are different models, have to look more and more like the universal cover. And this can be exploited in various ways to prove convergence, for any testable property of Riemannian manifolds. Now you get convergence of those parameters or properties. And you actually solve some problems that were not known. And I'm not going to detail, just mentioning this. So I can go two ways now. The first is I can tell you why it's worth to take graph limits, this kind of graph limits, because I never told you. So it's kind of like, OK, you can look at questions like that. So why is it productive to look at it? What's the extra force of considering limits? Or I can tell you this other type of convergence, this kind of local global convergence that tells you more about how to sample graphs. But then, I think I will do the first. Yeah. So I'm not going to local global. So why is it good and why would you do that? Why would you take, besides its own beauty, why would you take local limits or Benjamini-Schramm limits? So here is the deal. The deal is that you can set up a proving machinery. So take your favorite asymptotic, general asymptotic statement on finite graphs. Assume by contradiction that it's not true. Take a sequence of counterexamples. Now, by compactness, this sequence will have a convergent subsequence. So you know that there is a Benjamini-Schramm convergent sequence of counterexamples. Now take the limit. If you're lucky, then your negative assumption will say something about the limit. And many times, the ugly things, the ugly finite things from the finite statement disappears in the limit. So the limit statement will be much nicer. The assumption you get on the limit will be much nicer. Now, take this limit, use some analysis, or at least more analysis than usual in graph theory, and get a result in the limit universe, and then pull it back and get a contradiction. So this is the general setup for a proof machinery. And what's the extra force that allows you to prove things that you cannot prove for finite graphs directly? Why can you prove it for limit graphs? And here is the deal. The deal is that the limit graph, which is a random graph, a random rooted graph, behaves like a vertex transitive graph. In basically every sense I can think of. Okay? So that's good news. The good general news is that there is the theory of vertex transitive graphs in graph theory, which is beautiful and strong, but some people don't care about it so much because it's a very special class of graphs, and it smells like groups, of course. And there is the general theory of graphs, which a lot of people care about, and now we just built a bridge between them. So theorems that hold for vertex transitive graphs hold for limit graphs, or tend to hold for limit graphs. Okay, and that gets you a bridge between just ordinary finite graphs and vertex sensitive graphs, the universal vertex sensitive graphs. So I can tell you some examples for that. Probably I should tell just one example. And let me, the nice example that I have in mind is Stalling's theorem. Stalling's theorem says, that says that every vertex sensitive graph, infinite graph, has one, two, or infinitely many ends. Do you know this theorem? Okay, so every has one, two, or infinitely many ends. By ends, I mean the following. I just cut out a huge ball from the graph, and I look at the infinite components, infinite connected components of the rest. And I take bigger and bigger balls, and I take the limit of the number of components, number of infinite components. These are the ends of the graph. Okay? And I ask how many ends do I have? So this is a nice, old, very old theorem. And the proof goes as follows. Let me give a quick proof. So assume that the number of ends is at least 3, I claim that it's infinite. So set up a huge ball that already sets up the number of ends. Okay? So I take a huge ball, and there are all, of course, it's non-monotonely increasing, right? So that already has 3 components, 3 infinite components. But this is a vertex transitive graph. It looks the same from every point. So go into this infinite component and go very far in it. And now pick the R ball in here, the same ball. Then this rips this apart to 3 pieces. But only one piece, one infinite connected piece, can take care of this part. So you have a spread. You have a one more new piece, right? So in particular, you will have infinitely many, continue many pieces. That's the proof. Now, for limits of finite graphs, the same theorem holds. And a typical way of such a graph, which is a new and very useful theorem, is that you take a Cayley graph, like z square. And this doesn't look like z square, just imagine it's z square. And you do a percolation. You do an edge percolation on that. And you look at the component of the root, the connected component of the root. This is something that is central in percolation theory, the connected component. This will be a random rooted graph. And this will be a limit of finite graphs. Okay? Now the theorem says that for this random graph, which is not regular anymore, and you understand because it's a percolation that there are random bits, everything happens everywhere, every once in a while, still it's true that it has either one, two, or infinitely many ends. I mean, it can be finite as well. Okay? The proof is not the same, but it's similar. Okay? And let me just sketch the proof and end the talk. So first of all, in the case of percolation, you know. But in the case of a random rooted graph, this kind of random rooted graph, you assume that it's an ergodic space, meaning that it cannot be separated into two measurable parts. Now, once it's ergodic, you know that in this random graph, which is some strange graph, everything that happens every once in a while. This is a standard ergodicity argument. And now you, by ergodicity, the number of ends is a constant on that space because it's a measurable property. So now you let the number of ends be free, okay? Okay. Now take the following event. The event is that the r-ball around the root of that random rooted graph already separates it into k parts. Okay? This event has some probability, but as r tends to infinity, this is an increasing sequence of events, and the union is the full set. So for some r, it has positive probability. So there exists some r such that the probability that the r-ball separates it into k parts, okay, is already positive. This means that this exact event will happen every once in a while. It will happen infinitely often in this random graph. And then you can repeat the same proof. Okay? So, you can give a wrong proof. The wrong proof is that, of course, the infinitely many often you will see the same r-ball. But just because you see the same r-ball, just like, what was the speaker before? What's his name? Sarnak. Just like Sarnak said, this doesn't mean that it has, you know, it can happen that it crawls back. You know, just because you see the same ball from here, you know, you can still have much less components because in far enough, it just glues together and you never see it locally. But this is a measurable property and that's fine. Okay. All right. Thank you.